Ladies and gentlemen, good morning. My name is Richard Barons. I am a distinguished fellow here at the Royal United Services Institute. It's wonderful to see so many in the room for the launch of this important book. For those of you who don't know the Royal United Services Institute, this is one of, if not the oldest, think tanks in the world, formed in 1831 by the Duke of Wellington, and over the last 200 years has had a pivotal and independent role in the arena of defence and security policy, strategy, operations and capability based on its prodigious capacity for research, its networks and its reach into governments around the world. So one of the things the IUSI likes to do is to be the platform for the launch of important books that advance the business of defence policy, security, strategy and operations. And in our time, as many of you are thoroughly well aware, the challenge of what to do about Russia and what is it that Russia is doing has been very high up the agenda of the Institute and government and armed forces around the world. So I'm delighted to introduce you today Mark Galeotti, and he's going to talk for about 15 or 20 minutes about the book that he's launching. As you leave today, you will be able to take a flyer, which is important, because on the flyer is the discount code for the copy of the book that you are certain to buy on your way home. So Mark will talk 15 to 20 minutes, and then we'll have the balance of the time until 11 o'clock for your questions and opinions. And let's make that lively. When we get to it, could you please make your points as if you were wielding a rapier, not a sock full of custard? And then we'll get to the point as quickly as possible. So, Mark, over to you.
Thank you very much. I'll use the podium for the clicker. And yes, this is the very fine book, which is slender, but makes up for it by being expensive. And there is indeed a discount code that will allow you to bring the price down from being offensive to merely obscene. But that is, alas, the nature of modern academic publishing. Well, anyway, thank you very much. I'm delighted to be here. I am an undistinguished senior associate fellow here at RUSI, and therefore I am particularly pleased to be launching this book here. And really what I want to talk about is how we think about this thing that the Russians are doing, which in some ways we are now stuck with as a term of art to call it hybrid war, because it's been adopted and there's NATO centers of excellence and so forth, but which I don't think is necessarily a particularly useful term, particularly because I think our discussion in the West tends to conflate two or maybe even three different kind of phenomena and different kind of tactics together. So, obviously we at the moment are in the midst of the sort of hybrid war hype. We have Philip Breedlove sort of calling it sort of the greatest challenge coming out of NATO is the sort of from various forms of modern hybrid warfare. Of course, it raises the question of quite which wars have ever not been hybrid? Which wars have ever not had information, propaganda, and so forth dimensions? We have the House of Commons Defence Committee, which I still find it embarrassing that I need to include that little sick, because these asymmetric tactics, sometimes described as unconventional, ambiguous, or non-linear warfare techniques, are both more aligned to Russian strengths and considerably more difficult for NATO to counter. So yes, the Russians are using asymmetric warfare. They are clearly involved in what we can think of as a geopolitical guerrilla war against the West, a West that they are aware is much more powerful in almost every single index, whether we're talking military strength, political strength, economic strength, soft power. The reason for this is quite simple, and I'll just very, very briefly sort of talk about this. I mean, essentially, the Russian calculus is that they, and when I say Russia, I'm obviously talking about Putin and the sort of relatively small cabal of people to whom he actually still listens, seeking a great power status. And the problem is, when the Russians think of great power, they think of it in very 19th century terms. They don't think of it in terms of vibrant technological development, economic interconnectedness and soft power and so forth. They think of it in terms of sphere of influence, just ask the Ukrainians. Having a voice, and that means a veto, in pretty much every major global issue, regardless of whether or not Russia's interests are directly involved, because it's a matter of prestige, and also, more generally, a get-out-of-jail-free card. They don't want to necessarily destroy international norms and institutions, but they do want to basically be able to ignore international law and international norms when necessary. That, as far as Putin is concerned, is how a great power acts, and that's what he wants. And in a way, it's not about whether or not Russia is truly powerful. In some ways, Putin's point of view is that, well, Russia is Russia, and by definition, it deserves that. I mean, and we shouldn't be surprised. Back in 1999, before he was actual president, he said, Russia has been a great power for centuries and remains so. It has always had and still has legitimate zones of interest. We should not drop our guard in this respect. Neither should we allow our opinion to be ignored. Now, this was in 1999, when, quite frankly, Russia was not a failing state, but coming damn close to it. But that doesn't matter. It was because Russia has been a great power, Russia must be a great power. Now, of course, the thing is, we won't grant it. We are not willing to allow the Russians to basically build themselves umpteen loopholes in international law. We are not willing to sit back and see them bully their neighbours. We are not willing to sit back and let a country with an economy, depending on how you count it, somewhere between that of Italy and Spain, to pretend that somehow it is a nation that should be consulted on all issues and basically should consider to have a global writ. And the trouble is, our attempts to do that have been interpreted by the Russians as essentially hostile acts. And I think this is a really important point to make. It is not just propaganda when the Kremlin says that the West is trying to undermine the regime, that the West is hostile and opposed. They're wrong, but they are sincere. I'm still amazed by people whom I may well have known for years, sometimes to date myself, decades. Smart, well-informed, cosmopolitan figures within the Russian national security establishment and the military and so forth, who absolutely believe that, for example, the Ukrainian Euromaidan revolution was indeed made in Langley, a CIA plot, that somehow the Americans do have the capacity to destabilize regimes and not have it leaked to the Washington Post within a fortnight. The notion they have, you know, is that actually that they are embattled. Again, I'm not in any way supporting that perspective, but I'm saying we have to understand that that is a genuine perspective. And therefore, from Putin's point of view, this is an existential struggle for Russia, for its rightful place in the world, for its civilizational uniqueness. And this is why he has, in effect, brought Russia to a wartime footing, which has all kinds of other implications I'm going to touch on in a moment. But the idea is, therefore, we face a campaign which is intended not to conquer us, not to defeat us, not to necessarily change us. Putin doesn't really care what the West thinks, believes, does, how it lives, what values it embodies, so long as he gets what he wants. So what he has to do to allow him to, for example, bully Ukraine with impunity or whatever, is he needs us to be either neutralized or sufficiently battered and bamboozled that we feel we need to make some kind of a deal with him. I mean, let's face it, his dream would be some kind of Yalta 2.0, where we actually sat down and drew a line on the map and said, look, as long as you don't mess on this side of the line, that side of the line is yours. And obviously, from his point of view, Ukraine, Belarus, Georgia, and so forth would be on that side of the line. Incidentally, not the Baltic states. I think Putin, like pretty much all Russians, has internalized that the Baltic states are long lost. I once spoke to someone I knew who just retired from the Russian General Staff. And I said, look, you know, you must have contingency plans, because that's what soldiers do, for an operation against the Baltic states. Doesn't mean, you know, soldiers' job is to come up with contingency plans for any kind of stupid decision that their political masters might ask them to do. And he sort of kind of half nodded, and then there was this pause and a sigh, and he said, you know the trouble with the Baltic states? It's full of Balts. In other words, exactly, people who would resist fiercely and violently, and this would not be a struggle that the Russians were in. The Russians are not irrational. I think they are rational actors, often though bound by misunderstandings about the world, and Putin himself is also bound by the extent to which he's surrounded by people increasingly who tell him not what he needs to hear, but what they think he wants to hear. Rational actors can make very irrational decisions if they're fed poor information. But there is this belief that actually, if they keep struggling with us, if they keep messing with us and subverting us, eventually we will either be so paralyzed by internal divisions, by other concerns, by political logjams, that in effect Russia will have a free hand where it matters, or we will make a deal with Russia. I don't see it myself, but unfortunately Vladimir Vladimirovich didn't ask me about his strategy. But then, so I think when we look at hybrid war, I think we have to understand in some ways we're dealing with three different things. One is a genuine Russian belief that actually hybrid war is a Western invention that they are facing. I mean, the very fact that, what do they call it? Gibridnaya vojna. They just simply have Russified our own term for it. Second is actually a military notion of how you use non-kinetic activities to prepare the battlefield for when you're going to send in your troops, as we saw in Crimea and in the early stages of the Donbass, for example. And third, and I think most importantly, though, is a civilian notion that I think is best understood as political war. So let me just quickly sort of dwell on those three. I mean, Gibridnaya vojna, you know, there's this sort of infamous now notion of the Gerasimov Doctrine, which does not exist. It really does not exist. On my tomb, they will probably have carved inventor of the Gerasimov Doctrine, because I incautiously used that for a blog post and it ran. There is no such thing as a Gerasimov Doctrine. Sorry. It's a little sore point for me. But, you know, in this now infamous article in the absolute page-turner that is the military-industrial courier, Gerasimov reproduced essentially the text of a speech that he probably hadn't even written himself, it was written for him by his staff, in which he talks about this whole, the role of non-military means of achieving political goals and how important they are. We really should understand that when he wrote and said this, he was describing what he or what his people feel is the Western approach. That they look at the Arab Spring risings, they look at the color revolutions, they look at Euromaidan, and instead of seeing this as what happens when people finally become tired of unresponsive, corrupt, autocratic regimes, instead they think of this as some kind of political technology that the West, essentially America, uses against countries that it doesn't like, who happen to tend to be Russian clients or allies. So there is a sort of strong theme then. Now, the military, therefore, have been responding to a whole variety of different factors. First of all, you know, I mean, they use this term new generation warfare, which in its own way is as dumb as hybrid warfare. Because what does new generation mean? I mean, there's always going to be a newer generation. If this is new generation warfare, what are we going to have in 10 years' time? Newer, followed by newest? In many ways, what the Russians are grappling with is exactly the same as that which Western militaries are grappling with, and indeed the Chinese military is grappling with, which is that precisely in an age of exceedingly expensive, exceedingly capable, and in some cases exceedingly fragile military technologies, in an age in which we increasingly are dependent upon particularly communication systems, but also one in which actually the political context of war is shifting. We have become, and I'm delighted about this, very, very casualty averse. The days when you could just declare war, wave off 100,000 of your working class youths, knowing that sort of half of them are not going to come back from battle wounds, or more likely dysentery. But it's all right because, you know, there's more working class youths being spawned in the towns every day. That's long since gone. One death can become a political tragedy that actually pivots a whole political system. So in that context, that the Russians indeed are trying to work out how they can use a whole variety of non-kinetic methods to prepare the battlefield most effectively and to fight wars most effectively. And in that respect, it doesn't really matter if, as we've seen in Ukraine, you are vectoring artillery strikes with drones, or whether you are actually vectoring your artillery strikes by looking at concentrations of cell phone signals to tell you where the Ukrainian forces are, or indeed whether you're actually just simply sending messages to those cell phones saying, you're going to die. Doesn't really matter if you're attacking soldiers or attacking soldiers' morale. It's all part of the same continuum of warfare. And at the same time, the military are having to respond to the Kremlin's own concerns about hybridnaya vojna. And particularly Gerasimov's speech, it came at a time when the Kremlin was worried. And so he was basically just trying to reassure the Kremlin, saying, look, don't worry, guys. We're aware of this threat, and we're on top of it. So keep on funding us. Because after all, the chief of the general staff is not just a senior military figure, he is also the military's advocate within the policy process. But actually, if you look at how the Russian military talk about war and train for war and the military exercises, they are not primarily planning on sneaky spooks and trolls kind of operations. Still, their notion of war is an all-out massive combined arms operation, a shock and awe offensive rather than anything else. You start with all the sneaky stuff, but once you actually start the shooting, you go all in. Now, we know a lot about how the military are thinking about non-military means because they write about it a lot. There's quite a strong tradition. What we don't know much about is the civilian take, which is absolutely crucial. Russia has a very, very strong tradition of military subordination to the civil power because, this is a central part of communist rule. They're always very afraid of so-called Bonapartism, the military having too much power. So we shouldn't assume that the military get to define how they will be used. The Sovbiez, the Security Council, and the presidential administration are very, very dominant forces. And they are substantial forces that have a lot of influence in terms of working out how Russia will operate. And these are people who have a very strong awareness of the relative weakness of Russia on many levels, but who therefore are looking at, well, where is Russia strong? And the answer is obviously they feel it's in the political. So their notion is, in effect, that the key thing, remember, wars are fought for purposes. They have a political effect in mind. The aim is to strike at the will and the capacity of the West to act. It's not to try and conquer them. And therefore, they're looking for a strategy which will essentially divide, distract, and dismay us to the point where we are either forced into a deal or unable to act. Because they realize that there is currently no scope for success through military action. And in fact, the strategy that they have adopted is very, very close to that articulated by George Kennan in 1948, one of the sort of the veteran founders of American thinking about the Cold War. And when you talk about political warfare, it's a logical application of Clausewitz's doctrine in a time of peace. Essentially, it's the employment of all the means of nation's command short of war to achieve its national objectives, both overt and covert. Everything from propaganda to soft power to economic support and such like. And this, in my opinion, is what we are seeing that is the dominant Russian strategy being used against us. Kinetic means are just simply a way of achieving an objective. If you do not feel you can achieve that through kinetic means, you achieve it through non-kinetic means. So the military's route is political operations prepare the battlefield and then you fight. Civilians' route is they worked out, actually, we think we can get what we want without having to shoot. The military concept of hybrid war is, you might say, shooting plus non-kinetics. The civilian approach is we don't need to think about shooting. And this has evolved. I mean, in 2007, you had Alexander Vladimirov, a general who then moved into the civilian national security establishment as part of the Russian International Affairs Council. He said, modern wars are waged on the level of consciousness and ideas. Modern humanity exists in a state of permanent war. That's the point. Non-kinetic wars are not declared. They happen. They happen at different levels. They happen at different tempos. And this has formed, I can go into detail in the Q&A if people want, but actually, if we look at recent years, we can see the extent to which a whole variety of different events have contributed to this. 2008 Georgian War, in their sort of subsequent analyses, the Russians very much identified the importance of politics, propaganda, and information operations over and above the simple battlefield lessons, which is in part reflected in the 2010 military doctrine. The Bolotnaya protests in Russia, when you had massive protests against President Putin and the sort of the cavalier way in which they disposed of elections, actually was interpreted by many within the national security establishment as something that was, if not created by the Americans, but absolutely harnessed. and precisely became a sort of nightmare scenario for them. And in 2012, I'm still trying to track this down, but according to sources I've spoken to, in 2012, the Security Council Secretariat actually carried out an intensive internal modeling program of basically how could the West bring down this regime through sanctions, etc. And lo and behold, after the Crimean invasion, we then found sanctions being applied, and the hardliners, the hawks within the Security Council, were saying, you see, rather than saying, well, this is what happens when you annex part of another country, they were saying, you see, we said this is how they were going to do it. And indeed, increasingly, we have seen that normalized as part of the sort of national security establishment's mainstream dialogue and visible in a series of documents. In 2018, in some ways, I thought one of the most interesting sort of admissions came from Andrei Kortunov, you know, a scholar with very, very strong sort of government connections, who said that it seems that we all, in East and West, are beginning to love. That should be live, but it sounds much better this way. According to the laws of wartime, when all means are good. And as a result, for example, a very important red line between politics and a special operation is practically erased. Well, that's what we face. We face this multi-vector political challenge, political war from below, coming from a whole series of different actors. In effect, Putin is mobilizing every element of the Russian state, from the media to business to intelligence services to organized crime, when appropriate, in an attempt to try and undermine us. Driven by opportunity, there's no kind of grand plan. There will be a continued emphasis on intelligence and covert action measures. They will continue to develop scalable and versatile, even military political assets, including their Spetsnaz, their special forces. But that's the key point I think I want to end on. Russia is on wartime footing, but it's a different kind of war. They're not working out how many tanks they can churn out. They don't think they're ever going to be able to shift the, in my opinion at least, they don't think they're ever going to be able to shift the military balance between Russia and the West. Remember, NATO has more troops in Europe without the Americans and the Canadians than the Russians have got. It's this kind of statistic which we don't tend to talk about, but the Russians think about a lot. So instead, it's about mobilizing every other aspect of national authority. And therefore, we need to understand that while we keep our military deterrent posture, we in many ways have to actually match our kinetic defenses with our non-kinetic much more assiduously, using greater solidarity and target hardening us, which I'm happy to talk about later, because this is a challenge which will maintain as long as Putin is in power. Okay, I have just squeezed over my 20 minutes, but I shall stop there and move it to questions or furious rebuttals.
Good. Mark, thank you very much. So, who would like to wield the first rapier? Yes, far left at the room, at the back there. And could you please introduce yourself as you pose your question?
Oh, sorry. Michael Howell from Cross Border Capital. Mark, can I ask you a question to go back 25 years and look at the breakup of the Soviet Union? A lot of people were not foreseeing, clearly, the rise of Putin. And many historians were sort of putting this in the context of saying, this is the aftermath of World War I, we've had the demise of the Ottoman Empire, the Turkish Empire, now it's the Russian Empire. Now, in that context, why did Putin arise? Is it a blip? Should we expect the historians to be correct? And secondly, why is he looking west and not east? Because the big challenge is surely China.
Two excellent questions, both of which I will happily talk about for the next 3 hours. But to try and be a little bit more brief, we know Putin is obsessed with his historic legacy and where the historians will assess him. My view is that actually Putin will in many ways precisely be regarded as a transitional figure. In some ways, Putin is the last leader of the Soviet Union. In the sense of, I think he's the last generation of the Homo Sovieticus leaders who were actually raised and socialized under the Soviet system. And also, he is precisely that generation that had to cope with this seismic psychological shock, almost literally overnight, from being a citizen of one of the two great global superpowers to a citizen of a ramshackle and collapsing country that no one really cared about. I think this is in some ways part of the inevitable pains of end of empire.
And, you know, as we sit in Brexit Britain, I think it seems to be that actually it takes quite a while for countries to quite cope with that. So I mean, we shouldn't be surprised that the Russians will. But I think in the long term, I mean, I think he will be regarded as a sort of a transitional figure rather than anything else. But in terms of East versus West, I mean, in a way, the issue is, look, for most Russians, and I suspect it's for Putin as well, China is tomorrow's nightmare, but today's necessity. Yes, they are concerned about China. But you might say at the moment, China is not causing them any problems. China is not making any demands upon them, apart from just getting them to sell things and such like. And therefore, China is in some ways, by necessity, has to be a partner, I wouldn't say an ally, because of the pressure that the West is putting on them. If we in the West turned around to Russia and said, I'll tell you what, why don't we form some kind of grand anti-Chinese alliance or something like that? I'm not quite sure what Putin would say, because he would think of himself as, yeah, but we will be at the front line. But I do think that from the Russian strategic point of view, they are concerned about China, but they can't afford to allow themselves today to be addressing that problem, because the West is a more sort of salient one.
Okay, gentlemen, just next row in, and then we're going to come over here.
Thank you. Lee Willett, a former RUSI person. I don't know if you want to maybe break it down into such sort of black and white geographic terms, but I was quite struck, of course, by Sergei Lavrov's comments over the weekend about a Euro-Atlantic partnership. And if you look at, if you take a pretty dark view that Russia would be quite happy with the UK out of the EU and would be quite happy with the US discussing its commitment to NATO. You mentioned Ukraine and you mentioned Crimea and you mentioned Georgia. Do you see within this sphere of interest issue that you raise, do you see any concerns about potential Russian land grabs, and where do you see those potential vulnerabilities? Thank you.
Okay, thanks. I mean, Lavrov, bless him, he's been saying much the same thing. Well, the Russians have been saying much the same thing for decades. Euro-Atlantic partnerships and so forth. Basically, the Russians are happy with anything that actually attenuates the link between Europe and the United States, just as the Russians are happy with anything that attenuates whatever unity there is within the European Union. Because from the Russians' point of view, they basically are much, much more comfortable and feel much stronger dealing bilaterally with countries rather than with blocs that are larger and richer and so forth. I think that the Russians will delightedly make use of whatever divisions emerge, whether it's precisely Britain with the European Union, whether we're talking about separatism, whether it's in the UK or Spain or wherever, whether it's in terms of opening open rows between Hungary and Brussels. All of these things, they're all grist to their mill. They don't really care what the issue is. As long as it's divisive, they will happily magnify it insofar as they can. But again, I think in part the reason they do that so assiduously is precisely because of a lack of other alternatives. When we talk about land grabs, in some ways one of the problems is we've been conditioned by Crimea. Crimea was a very, very specific situation. First of all, it was a part of Ukraine that pretty much every Russian, whether they're a Putin fan or a Putin opponent, believed was part of Russia. It had a population which, to a considerable extent, felt it had been hard done by Kiev. There were already Russian troops present, and it was a particular time in which basically the Ukrainian forces were in absolute disarray and the chain of command also sort of very weak. It's hard to think of anywhere else where ordinary Russians would care about which could be as easily grabbed. People sometimes talk about a drive to the port of to the city of Mariupol in Ukraine. In 2014, that was a possibility. Today, given that at a time when Ukraine has had so much trouble reforming so many other aspects of its society, Ukrainian military has reformed dramatically effectively. We're talking about a very, very different kind of challenge that the Russians would deal with. Someone's talking about northern Kazakhstan, where there's a Russian population as a potential land grab area. Maybe once upon a time, but if nothing else, we have to accept the role of China in Central Asia, that they're probably unlikely to be happy to sit back and let that happen. And again, more to the point, ordinary Russians do not care about most of these areas. You know, they don't want to see their boys dying in the Donbass or Syria, let alone northern Kazakhstan or Belarus or wherever. And this is one of the reasons why the Russian state continues to lie about the presence of its troops in the Donbass. Not to convince us, we know better, but to reassure its own population. It's one of the reasons why the Russians created a mercenary organization called Wagner to fight in Syria, so that casualties could be ignored, because, well, they're nothing to do with us. They're just from a mercenary organization run by, you know, commissioned by the Syrians. So I think actually the scope for land grabs is distinctly limited. There are no more Crimeas lying around, for which I'm very pleased.
There we go.
Thank you very much, Ewan Grant, RUSI member, former fellow writer on Russian organized crime, strategic organized crime. Two quick questions. Your repeated point that significant aspects of Russian criminality are arms of the state. How well do you think that is being understood in the West? Because I do think it has taken a long time, and certainly you've been shouting this for a long time. And secondly, the European Commission central bureaucracy and its role in relations with Russia and Ukraine and Georgia, we all know the story, the saga around that. How much has the central bureaucracy, as opposed to the member states, taken on board the point you made at the very end about what the Western response should be? Integration of kinetic and non-kinetic, protection of infrastructure, full spectrum, or is it the case that if you meet Mrs. Mogherini's staff, are they at ease with you, or do they fail to look you in the eye? Thank you.
Okay, I mean, in terms of crime as an arm of the state, massive difference by member state, as you might imagine. And I think, again, this is inevitable but also alarming, because, again, I think the point is the way the Russians operate in Europe is not on the whole that they're carrying out crimes on the street. They're much more as a kind of the cash and carry, the facilitators who provide services, wholesale goods and so forth for domestic organized crime agencies. So, organized crime organizations. So that, you know, actually this gang selling heroin on the streets of London, or a gang involved in organized car theft in Poland, or a gang that is organized in trafficking people into southern Italy, may well and probably will be of locals. But actually, when you track, well, okay, where do they get their drugs from? Where do they launder their money? And where do they get their people from and so forth? Actually, the Russians sort of come into the chain. But the problem is, you know, certainly for most law enforcement agencies, their real priority is addressing crime on the street level rather than addressing some kind of notional potential wider security threat. So I think it's one of these is exactly the sort of challenge between, as it were, the role of security services and the role of, you know, police agencies. In terms of the European Commission and are Mogherini's people comfortable with me? Well, I'm a very easy person to be comfortable with. But joking apart, I think there is a really fundamental issue here that I've been very disappointed with. And I mentioned this point about solidarity. NATO is a phenomenally effective organization at doing a particular thing, which is precisely protecting its members from military threat. You know, and it's worth mentioning that however much we have concerns about, you know, how solid is Article 5 and so forth, I don't encounter that in Moscow. You know, Russians really do seem to feel that actually NATO is pretty much, in this respect, bulletproof. Maybe because in a way we all know our own weaknesses and we tend to sort of project strengths onto the other person. So too with the Russians. They don't seem to be worrying whether the Spanish would be willing to fight for Narva or something like that. But that's military. What we see, though, is the lack of anything comparable on non-kinetic threats. This is why, I mean, I thought it was so important and so heartening, the multinational response to the Skripal poisoning attempt. It was interesting, I was in Moscow at the time of Theresa May's initial speech and the initial expulsions. And again, everyone I was talking to in Russian circles assumed that that was an end to it. They carried out something in Britain, the Brits are going to respond, we're going to throw out a few British, you know, not a few, quite a lot, of British diplomats, but that'll be the end to it. And they clearly had gamed that out. And they didn't really think that that was going to be a problem, not least because, let's be perfectly honest, Anglo-Russian relations don't really have much further down to, you know, worsening to go. And then there was this wave, international wave of expulsions. And that really came as a very, I think, salutary shock to the Russians, because that does not tend to happen. On the whole, if it's non-kinetic, if it's a hack, if it's assassinations or whatever, countries are on their own. We don't tend to have solidarity. And that's exactly one of the areas in which the European Commission could be operating, because this is basically the areas of governance and political relations. But they're not. And another issue I would mention is we have this 2% of GDP figure of for defence that NATO members are meant to spend, even if many don't. But at least there is that sense of a benchmark. It's hard to do any kind of serious quantitative work because of just the data not being available. But I've done some initial stuff looking at European member states and the proportion of GDP that they spend on intelligence and counterintelligence. And there, the gap is literally orders of magnitude. In countries that actually spend quite solidly, the UK is one, Estonia, for example, is another, and countries which spend vastly less. And on one level, well, that's a national decision. Belgium wants to spend very little, that's a Belgian problem. Except it's not. In any alliance system, it is not just simply a national problem. I mean, I mentioned Belgium because we've had the recent case of a Belgian being identified as a Russian agent, but also because, gosh, Brussels happens to be in Belgium. And in fact, you know, a lack of counterintelligence capacity there actually has much, much wider impact. In alliance structures, weaknesses of one member become weaknesses of all. So, I mean, I think in this respect, what we actually see is that while we have internalized quite well this notion that we, you know, as a bloc, need to have certain standards and certain commitments to each other, and that actually does genuinely provide considerable levels of defense. In this realm of political war, there is nothing like that. Now, NATO can't do that job. NATO cannot parachute drop forensic accountants into Riga to look for corruption and dirty money flows. NATO cannot do all these other kinds of things. It's exactly what the European Union, as a governance-oriented body, could be doing. And sadly, at the moment, is not.
Thank you.
Who's next? Yeah, gentleman here, and then we'll come over there.
Hi, my name is Brady. Thanks for a nice talk. I'm looking forward to the book. I know you're a Russia scholar, and you're interested to circumscribe political warfare in that context. But you mentioned NATO has quite the fetish for the term, and I think you see that same fetish on the other side of the rivalry. But if we're going to replace it, do you think it could act as a framework to understand non-state actors like Hezbollah, which I think was the original paper that coined the term, or even other near-peer state adversaries like China, or smaller, let's say, less than near-peer adversaries like Iran, or even how the Saudis have been, you know, you could say, acting out, I think, in both a soft power and hard power way. But do you have any thoughts about that? Thank you.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, I think I'd make two points. I mean, one of them is I think generally speaking that, you know, we need to, in obviously definitional terms, scholars like definitions. You know, I mean, this is my problem with hybrid war is precisely because I have yet to find a war that isn't hybrid. And therefore we need to accept just simply that, you know, that armed conflict includes a whole variety of non-military means, but just so obviously different levels and different varieties. But the point is there will be shooting. And not just an individual assassination, but actually sort of armed conflict. Political war is all the non-shooting stuff. And in that respect, I think absolutely, it becomes, it is a term which is as relevant to other state actors as it is to, state-like non-state actors such as Hezbollah and so forth. Now, I mean, the problem comes down in terms of scaling. Actually is a street gang that intimidates local residents carrying out political war. So, I mean, there is a problem at sort of at that end of the scale. But no, I mean, I think the concept of political war is actually a very useful one. to understand, and I think how increasingly in the modern world we're going to see this, because it is something that in some ways the Russians, and also we should say the Chinese, have stumbled upon, is I think a reality of the modern world. Is first of all that war in a military term has become incredibly expensive. And I don't just simply mean in terms of the price of military kit, though the price of military kit has become ridiculously high, but also in terms of the political costs and the economic costs to society as a whole. But at the same time, we are now in a level of unparalleled global connectivity. That precisely means we are so much more vulnerable to a whole variety of non-military forms of aggression. Whether it's precisely in terms of propaganda, disinformation, and what is often, it's not just about disinformation, it's in some ways about how you slant realities, how you sort of actually just simply repaint what is really happening. And it's not actually as if most disinformation is an outright lie. It's just how you frame what's being said. We now operate in a media environment in which basically anyone with a Twitter feed is a media organization. The days when there were nice, a relative handful of gatekeepers who controlled, whether it's newspaper editors or TV channels or whatever, that's long since gone. And this is almost by definition a transnational one. Likewise, the interconnectivities of economics in ages of just-in-time and sort of global supply chains and such like, as we are discovering in the UK, actually mean that we are so much more interconnected than ever before. And that's great on so many levels, but it also brings with it these vulnerabilities that means actually whoever masters, it's not as if there's some kind of secret code and whoever gets it, that's it, they've won the game. But, the mastery of political war actually is going to be a very, very powerful, in my opinion, geopolitical asset in the future, because we're not going back to autarky. We're not going back to, even though the Russians may be playing with how they can switch off the internet, that's just a sort of a temporary defensive measure. The dynamic will be towards greater interconnectivity, not less, which actually will mean greater vulnerabilities to these kind of non-kinetic forms of conflict and competition. Again, a bit of a hobby horse of mine.
Yeah, and then we'll come into the middle.
Sebastian Brust from the Standing Joint Forces headquarters here in Northwood, although I'm from the Netherlands. Question, I'm trying to grab this. What is the intent of Russia in the future? You mentioned something like they're not interested in land grabs like we saw in Crimea. So that was one of my questions. Are there indicators and warnings that we see some land grabs in the future? But I'm trying to get hold of what is Russia, what is the aim of Russia? Is that only breaking, for instance, the coalition within the EU and the NATO? But looking at Venezuela, for instance, Wagner groups, 200 persons were seen in Venezuela the last couple of weeks, picking up maybe debts of Venezuela. But what is Russia after? Is it becoming a great power, to become more great power, that we depend on Russia? Is that what they are after? Because they're also not complying to the INF, the nuclear treaty. So what are they particularly after? That's what I'm after.
Okay, first of all, just as sort of a ritual note, I would mention that we should also bear in mind that however much he might disagree, Russia is not Putin and Putin is not Russia. In some ways, we have ordinary Russians who, on the whole, what do they want? Yes, they want to feel that their country is respected and so forth, but basically, they want a nice life. They want to be able to buy iPhones and travel to package holidays in Turkey and such like everyone else. There is a Russian elite which, in my opinion, is on the whole not really interested in grand ideological crusades against the West. Essentially, is pragmatic and kleptocratic. They just want the freedom to be able to steal in peace at home and then conveniently move that money into Western banks to keep it safe while they send their families and their mistresses to expensive pads in London and they can holiday in the south of France and such like. But they themselves are in some ways hostages, not that we should feel sorry for them, of Putin and a relatively small handful of people around him who I think are committed to what we might think of as a much more ideological project, which is absolutely about Russian great power status, about reasserting Russia as it has, in Putin's view, historically always been a great power. And what that means, as I said, I ran through in brief terms, the sort of the intents. But first of all, we've got to realize a lot of this is emotional. This is about people who feel that their country has been treated badly, has been slighted and ignored for too long, and now needs to be reasserted as a sort of one that matters. They're often, it is very much about esteem and how the rest of the world treats them. It has obviously certain kind of practical dimensions. Retaining as both economic dependencies and buffer states the other, or most of the other post-Soviet states, is clearly sort of important as a specific objective. But in general terms, I don't believe that they have a kind of a grand offensive strategy in the sense of specifically thinking, okay, we want to shatter the European Union, break NATO, or anything like that. I mean, if they had the option to do so, they'd be delighted. But the point is, it's not that specific. The political objective, in my view, let me quote someone from the Russian Foreign Ministry who I was talking to, who said, basically speaking, our aim is to stop you from stopping us. And I think that is probably one of the most succinct summaries of the real Russian objectives. Is in a way, they want to assert themselves in the world, they feel that we are preventing them doing so, and therefore they need to ensure that we can't do that. And if that means breaking up the European Union, okay. They probably don't expect that they're going to be able to do that. I mean, if anyone's going to do that, it's going to be the Europeans. But on the other hand, they will happily magnify whatever tensions they will find. This is an essentially opportunist campaign, and it's an opportunist campaign coming from a position of weakness. I think that's really important to stress. I mean, this is, one of my particular concerns expressed in another book due out this week, We Need to Talk About Putin, available from Penguin Random House, coming out tomorrow, is that we have too often this tendency to assume that Putin is some kind of grand geopolitical three-dimensional chess player who has a sophisticated strategy that working out, moves 5, 10, 15 moves ahead. I don't see that. Again, if we're going to use the sort of cliched parallels, it's actually the fact is that judo is really Putin's sport. And when you go into the ring, yes, you have a sense of your antagonist's trademark moves and how you may well respond to them, but essentially you go into the ring, you see what opportunities are going to present themselves to you, and you will seize those opportunities. And that, I think, is what the Russians are doing. The Russians just simply feel that we need to be made to feel weak. We need, in some ways, to be made to feel scared of Russia, so that either we will back off or we will make a deal with them. And in a way, everything that contributes to that is useful. And this is why, we have such a varied and multidimensional struggle that we face. That on the one hand, you have the Russians reaching out to the alt-right, and on the other hand, you have them reaching out to populist left. You have them presenting themselves as the friend of authoritarian regimes and also the friend of liberal popular regimes. There is no ideological base to this. It is purely pragmatic, it is purely opportunistic, and it is purely about creating mischief on the principle that 4 out of 5, 9 out of 10, 19 out of 20 of their individual little gambits will not work. But the point is, as long as a few will work, they will push it. So I think this is one of the problems about saying, well, what do the Russians want? Because it is not something specific. It's not like saying they want Ukraine to be part of Russia, end of story. It is not that they have some nice, neat end game. Their end game is that they are respected, that they have what they regard as strategic autonomy, and that the West stops trying to undermine them. And just a last point I would make on that, how are we trying to undermine them? Well, the point is, when we, for example, critique failures of the rule of law in Russia, or critique corruption in Russia, and so forth, we're on the whole doing so because, however imperfectly, we do seek to embody a certain value-based foreign policy. To the Russians, this is gibridnaya voyna. This is, they're using the issue of corruption or whatever, or a rule of law, as a way of trying to undermine us. There is a certain, and again, I think it's people like Putin and people like his head of security council, Secretary of Security Council, Nikolai Patrushev, who incidentally makes Putin look like a dove in some ways. I mean, this is a guy who genuinely seems to believe that a psychic read Madeleine Albright's dreams and thus knows that America wants to dismember the Russian Federation. But, you know, I keep asking people who sort of have a much better insight, you know, really? Does he really believe that kind of stuff? And so far, most people have said, probably yes. You know, to these people, what we are doing looks like trying to destabilize Russia when viewed through that paranoid prism. And that's the problem. So a lot of it is actually pushing back against an offensive that they think they are facing. So I've given you a very long, very hazy, very wobbly answer. But that's because, unfortunately, I think it reflects the difficulty. Even if you had Putin here and you had him dosed up on truth drugs and asked him, what do you really want? I don't think he could probably give you a much better answer.
So, gentlemen here, and we are.
Hi, my name is Alexander. Russia's demonstrated its potential within cyber-kinetic and non-kinetic spheres within Estonia, Ukraine, as you mentioned, etc. Do you think that our perceived lack of political will is emboldening them, and do you think we're sort of going to be left behind, getting tangled in the weeds of like law of armed conflict, etc., and ethics, rather than what the Russians are doing and basically just going, do it and ask questions later, sort of thing?
Yeah, I mean, there is definitely a point about the sort of the Russian approach. Again, I think this reflects this business of wartime versus peacetime mentalities. I mean, this is a slight sort of sideline, but, you know, I mean, at the time of the Skripal attempt, there was all this talk about, oh, is Putin furious with the military intelligence, with all their blunders and so forth? And I thought, I couldn't see any signs that he was. And then he gave a speech at the 100th anniversary of the GRU, which was totally laudatory. I kind of read through it, trying to find even the slightest hint of critique between the lines, and there was nothing. And I think that reflects the fact that, look, in wartime, you accept a certain amount of frictional loss. And that, I think, is how the Russians, you know, sort of conceptualizing it. Yes, I mean, the outcome of the Skripal case politically actually proved to be much more damaging than they'd expected. But the point is, yes, in war, you fight, you hope to win the battle, but the ultimate thing is you have to win the war. And if that means you lose a few battles on the way, that's no biggie. I think that is the Russian mentality at the moment, which we obviously don't share, because we are thinking of this as peacetime, and we're thinking much more about issues of proportionality, and can one genuinely attribute, you know, who's behind things and such. It becomes a lot trickier. You know, Pearl Harbor, it's not actually anyone said, but they might have just simply been planes that looked Japanese. No, you know, at a certain point, you just simply think, well, we're sure we know what's going on. So that is a problem for us. But again, it's the same kind of problem that law enforcement has against the criminals. If only they could use the same methods as the criminals, they'd be a lot more effective. But at what cost? I mean, you know, we have to stick to what we're good at. But I think I would want to make one very specific point about cyber attacks. Yes, so long as it looks as if there's no particular cost. It's attempting, you know, these mass DDoS type campaigns are attempting one. But, you know, first of all, you know, NATO has at least said now that it would regard it also, you know, that it actually embraces this as within the concept of offensive operations, which is useful. But also, we again should not be blinded to our own strengths and the other side's weaknesses. The interesting thing is that when you talk to people in Russia, they are aware that there is a technological gap, and they imagine that we in the West have all kinds of cyber capacities that would be very scary for them, which I would hope we do. I mean, except that, you know, cyber is just one of these areas where, you know, you do not basically flaunt your capacities until you want to use them, because once you use them, other people can copy them. It's not something where a particular exploit gets trundled through Red Square on the back of a truck, for, you know, impressive. Most of the Russian cyber attacks have actually not been that complex. You know, a lot of them have just been mass DDoS attacks or spear phishing or that kind of thing. There is, from the Russians' point of view, the risk that if it came to war, I think they're not concerned that NATO is going to be sending tank divisions spearing towards Moscow, because how many tank divisions has NATO got these days? They're more concerned about precisely the fact that, what, your average Russian city has enough food stored for 1.5 days, and if we could crash the control systems of Russian railways, Russians would start getting hungry really quite quickly. If we could crash the power systems in the middle of winter, that means something if you're in the middle of a minus 40 Yekaterinburg winter or whatever. I mean, for all these reasons, actually, I think the Russians have a sense of our own capabilities. So that, yes, we are slightly hamstrung, but in terms of our initial response, by the fact that we are still trying to be the good guys, or at least the legal guys. But I think there's also, from the Russian sense, a distinct notion of a limit to how far they can go. And actually, the more we respond, the more we demonstrate solidarity and a willingness to respond politically and so forth, actually, we are pushing that threshold further down. So I think, actually, this is an unsung success story, because precisely, you don't see it, because the Russians aren't going to say, well, we were actually going to launch a massive attack on the Netherlands, but we decided not to because of the risk. It just doesn't happen. You don't know if it doesn't happen for whatever reason. But the impression I get, though, is that the Russians, ever since the response to the Estonian attack, and the fact that NATO decided to actually treat this more seriously, I think they thought, bugger, it's not quite so easy now to use it against NATO countries.
So we have time for two more questions, and I'm aware we're about to have an equality and diversity drama. So we'll go with the gentleman in the far left, and then the lady here in the second.
Hi, Tim Vogue. Could you comment on the German gas supply issues, and whether that's a strength or a weakness, and also how Trump changes the mix with Putin?
Okay, so you thought you'd go for easy questions just to end with. Let's talk about Nord Stream 2, first of all. I think that we need to distinguish between, shall we say, the economic and the political. The days where I really worried about Russia's capacity to use energy as a weapon are pretty much gone. The Russian economy now, they need to be pumping petrol, oil and gas, and they need to be selling it. They really can't really afford not to be doing so. And therefore, I think the scope for sort of leverage there, except in terms of Ukraine, in practical terms, I don't see as that great. But the issue is that this has become a kind of political touchstone point, that you have the Americans, who are not entirely without self-interest, given that the alternative is we buy a lot more of expensive American LNG, are very much pushing this as how can Europe be helping the Russians with this? And you have the Germans pushing back. And to this extent to which this has become about macho politics as well. And I think this is one of my areas of concern, is that not so much that I care that much about Nord Stream. There are other people who will know a lot more about the sort of the details of its impact. But too often in the West, what we do is we create easy wins for the Russians politically, by precisely creating situations where the Russians can then basically aggravate tensions on both sides. And they do. And the interesting thing is, this is just purely secondhand, but I was talking to someone I know in the States who says that actually they think that the Russians are pushing the whole anti-Nord Stream 2 narrative. I don't know if that's true or not, because it would seem perverse that the Russians would be pushing a narrative against a Russian pipeline. But I suppose if they reckon that it's going to happen anyway, why not build up the political tensions around it? So I think this is it. This is really a more of a political issue. And that, I suppose, leads us into the Trump thing. Look, I've never bought the idea that the Russians thought they were going to get Trump elected, or indeed wanted Trump elected. I think they were absolutely certain that Hillary Clinton was going to win. They were worried about that, again, from the kind of Gibrinaya Voina point of view. It's amazing the reputation that Clinton has in Russia in official circles as an enemy of Russia and Russians. And I think they generally felt that the Clinton presidency would be one that was committed to, at the very least, much more aggressive containment of Russia, and at most, actually, some kind of regime change campaign. And to that end, I think they were trying to stir up so many problems for her when she was elected that she would be too busy putting out fires domestically. And then they got Trump. And on one level, are they delighted to see the extent to which Trump dismays, divides, and generally demoralizes the West? Yes, of course. But at the same time, I mean, actually, American policy towards Russia is tougher than it's been under President Obama. And I think they have no real doubts that Trump would have no problem, if need be, throwing them under a bus. The image I tend to feel is how the Russians approach Trump is they find themselves locked in a big room, perhaps like this, with an insane elephant. And at the moment, the elephant is at the far end trampling the other guys. And that's great. But you know that at any point the elephant could come and trample you as well. So it's not entirely comfortable either. The ultimate thing is this. The Russians did very well by having a very predictable and frankly mature United States. Because they got to play the role of the unpredictable mavericks, the bad boys of geopolitics, because they knew exactly where the red lines were and exactly how far they could go and what the likely outcomes would be. With Trump, I mean, yesterday's red lines are not today's. The red lines are probably in crayon anyway. You know, for all these reasons, they cannot do that. And so I think it's quite interesting why, for example, we have seen the Russians actually testing the Americans much, much less under Trump. You know, whether it's in terms of buzzing, you know, U.S. Navy warships or whatever else, actually they are much more pressurizing Europe than America. And I think that's in part precisely because they don't know how far they could go with Trump. So I think the Russians' point of view, it's an awkward and uncomfortable situation.
So final question from the lady in the second rank here.
Hello, Lucy Hrushkova, Renaissance Strategic Advisors. So my question is a hypothetical. So where NATO's credibility and deterrence become less, so through, for example, well, we've just discussed Nord Stream, Trump, where there's become, where there'd be a disunity in terms of goal. What would that change in Russian thinking about political war or the dynamic that you've described? So my question is more about the mechanics. So if the European disunity would increase, would the Russians somehow change their approach?
I see no signs that Putin has any kind of territorial ambitions. His ambitions are political. And again, I mean, this is not me trying to whitewash. It's just that actually, I think one thing the Russians realize is they're invading Poland gets them what? Other than a war with a lot of thoroughly annoyed Poles. You know, I mean, actually, first of all, just the days where sort of power was measured in territorial terms are pretty much gone. You know, if one could point to some massive, extraordinary resource, you know, if there were the famous oil fields of Silesia, then, okay, maybe the calculations might be different, who knows. But in practice, there is nothing really to be gained. Now, of course, the gains are political. One of the reasons for, you know, political war is to break down countries' sense of security and make them feel insecure. And this is why, for example, you know, Russian military exercises are not just training operations. They are also acts of political theater. And they're very carefully calibrated often to convey certain messages. When they're, you know, when they're trying to warn the Scandinavians not to think about joining NATO or basing ABM systems, they'll war game nuclear attack or a strike to take a Swedish island or something like that. You know, they're very well aware that we will sit there and look at what's going on. So the Russians will absolutely, you know, will have much more scope to look scary, and therefore be more likely to, you know, perhaps incline proportions of the population to say we need to make a deal with Russia or whatever. But again, I think that we are talking about political rather than military likely ends. I see no signs that the Russians, if nothing else, that the Russians really could sustain major military operations beyond Russian gauge railway territories. You know, I mean, there's all kind of practical reasons as well.
As ever, it comes back to logistics.
Thank you very much. So, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for coming. Thank you for a set of really absorbing questions. I hope you've learnt as much from this hour as I have. Thank you to Mark. And books don't get written if people don't buy them, and the flyer's on the way out. So I think we'll close with a round of applause for our author. Thank you so much.